Good morning, Shavua Tov. We are in the third installment of Rambam. So it's going a little longer than usual, but you know, the person we are speaking about, I think, is worth discussing for another shiur. So it's fine. And we spoke in the last two shiurim, we spoke about the personal biography of Rambam, and even then we couldn't cover all aspects of this great personality. And what we want to do this week, this meeting, is to go through some of his Torah. Now, I was sitting down yesterday night and I was wondering, I was trying to find a few paragraphs that would be a combination of interesting. I think that's a key element. So it should be interesting. It should be informative. So I want us to learn, not only, we can bring letters from Rambam. I think I spoke about what we found in the Geniza, which some of them are just gossip. It's interesting to know, things about Rambam's life, but I wanted us to learn Torah. So I was looking for things that would be interesting, informative. I was also trying to find things that would be representative, and representative in both ways. One is that it would be representative of just Rambam's Torah, so not just another halacha, but things that are main keys of Rambam's way of thinking, representing Rambam thinking in the different realms, and also representative in the sense of representative the books, the sefarim that I was taking them from. So for example, if I'm taking a quote from Perusha Mishnah, I was looking for something in which as many aspects, elements of Perusha Mishnah would stand out. Now, I completely failed in the attempt to find sources that would cover all of these requirements. So I was sorting them along the order I just gave. So for me, the most important thing would be interesting, because we want all to keep focused, and then informative and representative in whatever I was able to achieve. So if someone really wants to get a hold on what Perusha Mishnah is, I would suggest just learning Perusha Mishnah and not relying on what I am going to bring here. By the way, if we speak about the Mishnayot, it's important to note that yesterday they began a new cycle. There are people who learn two Mishnayot a day, and they cover the whole Shas Mishnayot, I think in a couple of years or 3 years, something in that direction. And they began yesterday a new cycle, two Mishnayot a day. They have a new app, which is it's not completely new. I think it's 2 or 3 years old, which is called the Keati app, and in which you have the whole of the Keati for free in English and in Hebrew. So that's in itself, you know, even without learning every day, just having that, I think that's amazing. It's very nice of the Yorshim of Kehati to just give their permission to have the whole thing for free. And you can use it, so just look on your, I don't know if they have it on iPhone, I have it on Android. So you just go into the App Store and you write Kehati and up it goes. So I would just suggest if anyone wants, then he can use, he can join the learning, join the Mishnah learning. So they began yesterday, it's two Mishnayot a day, not too difficult to make up for the last day if you begin today. And just that's I think a nice thing to do. I also believe that if you are looking for Perusha Mishnayot La Rambam, I didn't search for it yesterday night, but I do believe that also exists for free somewhere over the internet or in an app. Okay, so that, Sapphire, yeah, that's right, you have Sapphire. Thank you, you're right. Sapphire, by the way, if anyone here doesn't know Sapphire, then that's another very good recommendation that you'd go online, just click Sapphire, and that's an amazing site. What they have there is unbelievable. and the ability to, again, Hebrew and English, not everything there is translated, not everything, but I think all of the basic texts, including the Ol Shas Bavli, the Ol of Shas Yerushalmi, I think they have the Steinsatz edition. I think it's all online for free there. So that's another amazing resource. I'm using that a lot. So amazing resource and very easy. It's all hyperlinked. So you are learning the Gemara and there is a Pasuk. You can click on the Pasuk. It's open another window with the Pasuk and you can then click on the Pasuk and you have 25 Mefarshim. It's amazing. It's really an amazing tool. Very much recommended. Okay, so all of that was completed. Digressing from the topic, so returning to the topic at hand, which is Mishnah Rambam. Just a second, I have 6 years for the Kehati, so I'm behind.
Kehati is
also on the iPhone. Okay, so that's so I'm behind on the events. I was using the Safari. What can I say? I'm using the books. it's books. Yeah, there is such a thing. Yeah, amazingly. They still produce them for Shabbat, as they say. Okay, so we want to go to the Rambam. Perush HaMishnah LaRambam. So as I said, we would learn, Bezot Hashem, if I would be able to hold myself not to the guess of the minute, and you just learn the Rambam, then what I hope to be able to do today is learn from Rambam three main compositions, three main works. The Perush HaMishnah, we spoke about them last week. The Perush HaMishnah is commentary on the Mishnah. His Mishneh Torah, his Code of Laws, and his Moreh Nevuchim, his Guide for the Perplexed, which is his main philosophical work. So that's a lot on our plate. Let's begin. Our first source is from Perush HaMishnah LaRambam, Avot. So I took a Mishnah from Pirkei Avot because I wanted to be immediately known to everyone and just to begin to learn something from Kilayim now seemed to me too difficult. So I took from Avot, Perek Gimel, Mishnah Tetvav. It's a Mishnah by Rabbi Akiva. So Rabbi Akiva says, Hakol Tzafui veHareshut Netuna. So Rabbi Akiva says everything is expected. God knows everything in advance. Ve'hareshut netuna. But you have permission to do whatever you want. So obviously that's a contradiction. Right? Because if God knows what you're going to do, how can you say that I can do whatever I want? I need to do what God knows I will do. So that's the famous problem for knowledge and choice. Free will and determinism, it has a different shape every generation, but it's the basic question of free will. Are we as persons really have free will, or are we determined by predestined? By the stars in some generations, by God in other generations, by science in a third generation, by genetics, physics? There are many things on which we can, and now I will say something which obviously is judgmental, but there are many ways in which we can take out the responsibility from our shoulders and throw it on something else. And every generation, it takes a new shape. So Rabbi Akiva says in the Mishnah, everything is foretold and the choice is given. Uvetov or betov ha'olam nidon. The world is judged in a favorable way. So that's an unclear sentence. Obviously, we want to see how Rambam would explain it. So the world is judged in a favorable way. Ve'hakol lefi rov ha'maaseh. And everything goes according to the majority of your deeds. Again, these are ambiguous sentences. We can translate them or we can explain them in different ways. We are interested in what Rambam has to say. Let's begin. Now I begin the Perusha Rambam. Says Rambam, Ze ha-ma'amar, this statement, kolel inyanim gdolim meod. We have here important issues, long topics that are being discussed. Ve'lo yudvarim kemo elu, Ela le Rabbi Akiva. He says it's very appropriate that such smart things
would be said by someone as Rabbi Akiva. So that's a, to me, and that's maybe a personal thing, but to me, such a sentence by Rambam is very meaningful. On one hand, he says nothing. Right? It's appropriate to Rabbi Akiva. It was Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi who said that it's appropriate to Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, right? But you see here how Rambam related in almost a personal way to the sages. And because when he says to you, ah, it is appropriate for Rabbi Akiva to say such a thing, right? That would be like we all sit around the table and you are expecting, I mean, if there are type of shiurim in which only the speaker is speaking, in, as we do now, and there are other types of shiurim in which it's more of a round table, like it's more of a discussion, and people contribute. And obviously in the Talmud, in the Mishnah, it was an open discussion. You don't have long intercourses by one rabbi giving a lecture. What you have in the Talmud is always a debate, a discussion. So imagine that we sit around the table and one of the attendees is raising his hand and you almost know even before he begins to speak what basically his position is going to be. And that comes out of a very personal feeling and knowledge of the different people sitting around this table. And Rambam says, you know, this is so appropriate for Rabbi Akiva to try to hold to both ends. So he's not going, it's very easy to say there is free choice and to somehow minimize maybe the foreknowledge of God. There are some Rishonim few that went in this direction. Another direction one can take is to say, yeah, God is omnipotent and he knows everything and that's why he has all the foreknowledge. What about human free choice or free will? Well, that's a type of an illusion. There are more Rishonim that went in that direction. But Rambam says it's so beautiful that Rabbi Akiva is trying to hold both ends of this rope, I guess, and to twist them both in two contradiction directions. It doesn't give us the answer how it can be done, but this should be our aspiration, not to let go of each one of these of the ends of this dilemma, the corners of this dilemma. So horns, right? That's the right word, the horns of the dilemma. So says Rambam, וזהו פירושם בקיצור. ובתנאי שהבנת מה שקדם בפרקים הקודמים. So Rambam says, I'm going to explain to you how these two things can live together, meaning God's foreknowledge and our free choice, but I'm going to speak about that shortly, and it depends on you knowing what I already explained. What he's referring here to, I suppose, is to the eighth chapter of the Shmona Prakim, of the eight chapters. Now, the eight chapters are his introduction, his long introduction to Pirkei Avot. And in the eighth chapter of this introduction, he introduces the concept of free will and free choice and speak in length why it doesn't contradict Psukim in the Torah. We just read Parshat Shavua, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu hardened the heart of Paro. Right, so does that contradict the concept of free choice? So Rambam has an answer to that. So he goes in length explaining why free choice does exist regardless of what seems to be contradicting verses in the Torah. And he also goes into the more philosophical question of God's free foreknowledge, does it contradict free choice? So he seems here to refer us back to there. I would try to somehow give it in even a shorter version here as we would speak. So let's read what he has to say. Amar, so what did Rabbi Akiva said? Kol ma sheba'olam yadua etzlo it'ale. So everything in this world is known to God. Vehu masigo. And God has understanding or knowledge. Vehu omro, and that's what Rabbi Akiva said, hakol tzafui. Everything is already foretold. Everything is expected to happen. Achar kach amar, velo tachshov, you shouldn't think, shebeyoto it'ala yodea ha-peulot, itchayev ha-ichrach ושיהיה האדם כפוי על פעולה מן הפעולות. Do not think that because God knows in advance what you are going to do, that means that you are forced into a specific act. אין הדבר כן, that is not correct. אלא כל אדם בוחר במה שיעשהו. Every man can choose what he will do. והוא אומרו, והרשות נתונה. Meaning that the ability is given to you. רצונו לומר, רשות כל אדם נתונה לו. Every person has a free choice. In the eighth chapter of the Shmona Pakim, the introduction, Rambam says, each one of us can choose, he can be as righteous as Moshe Rabbeinu, or as corrupted as Yerovam ben Nevat. So these are the two poles he give. Moshe Rabbeinu, meaning Moshe Rabbeinu is obviously, he's a Navi regarding whom the Torah explicitly says, no one would ever be as Moshe Rabbeinu. Rambam says, you have the ability, the potential to be as Moshe Rabbeinu. And you can go as low, as down as his example is Yerovam ben Nevat. That was the first king of the northern kingdom. You remember that the Israelite kingdom was split into two in the days after Shlomo HaMelech, in the days of Rehavam. And the northern kingdom was headed by a person named Yerovam ben Nevat, who began as a tzaddik, but power corrupts, and power did corrupt him. In order to stay in power, he understood that if he would control religion, that would give him power over the people. That's basically what was going on there. So he pursued the people, instead of going to Beit HaMikdash and worshiping HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to go to temples that he erected in Dan and in Shomron, and instead of worshiping HaKadosh Baruch Hu, worshiping Lehavdil, the calves, the golden calves, the Egel HaZahav. So that was in order to be able to control the people, because if you are in control of the priests, and if you made up everything, then obviously that makes you the head of the pyramid. So that was basically Yerovam ben Nevat. So that's as bad as it goes. It's not only Avodah Zarah, it's Avodah Zarah for the masses. Right? So it's completely corrupting the Jewish faith, and that's what he set to do. So you can be either Moshe Rabbeinu, who gave the Torah, or you can be Yerovam ben Nevat, that completely banished the Torah. And it's up to each one. Each one has the potential to go all the way up or all the way down. So that's an amazing statement by someone as Rambam, who is usually very practical, very rational. Rambam says, on that front, you can go all the way. All the way. So that's very, I think it's very empowering. Obviously, it's also very threatening, but it's very, very empowering. So, הרשות נתונה, we have the ability. How does it stand up with a kol tzafui? I would give you Rambam's formulation in very short, because that's a very philosophical debate that he's going into. But basically what he says is that God, when we speak about HaKadosh Baruch Hu, we have to understand that our language is not apt to speak about God, because God is spiritual, and our language is completely non-spiritual. Even when we speak about the spiritual things, so what is the name that we give? Spiritual. Why do we call spiritual things, not physical things? Why do we call them spiritual? Because spirit, wind, we may say, right, is the closest thing in this physical world to a non-physical being, right? Am I correct? So we do not have even a word which is really non-physical to say spiritual. We use a physical word. We speak about spirit, which in the end is physical, right? In order to speak about the non-physical world. The only accurate thing we can say about the spiritual world is that it is non-physical. So I just tried to give you in three sentences what is called the negative attributes theory. That is in Hebrew, Torat HaTeharim HaShlili'im. That means that we cannot say anything positive about God. We can only say positive and negative. I do not mean in the moral sense, obviously. I mean in the philosophical sense. So you cannot even say, now we'd say something which is scandal. You cannot even say that God exists. Okay, so how a rabbi is sitting here and saying that we cannot say that God did. What do I mean by that? And that Rambam says that explicitly in his Moreh Nevuchim. What do I mean by that? I mean a very simple thing. When we speak about exist, all of our experience, and that's everything that we can symbolize with the word exist, is for, again, physical entities. Now, physical entities can exist, so the stable is here, but they can also not exist, right? So the word existing, existent, is taking into account also the ability to not be in exist, okay? So existence in our world, in our experience, in what we can speak about, is always conditioned. It can either be or not be. I believe I exist, I hope so, but I also know that 45 years ago, I was not in existence. And I mean, it's sometimes it's sad to admit, but I would imagine that 85 years from now, it seems that I also not be in existence. So I exist, but my existence is conditioned. It can either be or not be. And everything around us, when we speak about existence, in existence, we speak about things that can either exist or not exist. So the word exist is not apt regarding God, because God cannot be non-existing. Per definition, he cannot be non-existent. So you cannot really say that God exists. Just to give us some think about that, thought about that, can we say that the number four exists? All right? So that's a, by the way, that was a long, long debate in the medievals, which I am not going to go into even near, but just to give us some sense. All right? So the word four, does it exist? Does it not exist? I don't know. The number four. So in the same sense, can you say that God exists? It's not the same existence. So the closer thing that you can say is that he does not exist in the same sense that we exist. But the shorter version, we say, he does exist, right? But that's a shorter version, because what we really have to say, he exists, but not in the same way we exist. After saying that, the same is true regarding his knowledge. So God does know. God does know. But his knowledge is not like our knowledge. And we cannot say anything positive about his knowledge. Just like about his existence. We can only say that he knows, but not with our knowledge. Taking that into account, Rambam says, so there is no more contradiction between God's knowledge and our free choice. Because only knowledge the type of knowledge that we know, limits the options to one possibility, which is what we know. But God's knowledge can coexist with all the possible outcomes, and still it would be knowledge. Now, I don't know how it goes, but I don't know also how God exists. So that's not something new, that we cannot understand something about God. Now, I want to emphasize, Rambam does not take here the easy route, just saying, we cannot know. I mean, that is just saying something out of ignorance. Rambam is very detailed in explaining to you why you cannot know that. Now, that's very important. People, for example, that are into mathematics know that there is a big difference between having equation that I don't know how to solve it. Okay, so you are an ignorant. You don't know how to solve it. That's one thing. The other is, I am able to prove to you that this equation is not solvable, but at least not by human beings. So that's a very different type of not knowing. One is the not knowing of the ignorant, and the other is people can get a Nobel Prize for proving that something is unprovable. So the other is the unknowing of the expert. Rambam is advocating the unknowing of the expert. That is, our knowledge about God And Rambam thinks that knowing about God, that's the highest perfection that human being can aspire to. All this knowledge is the ability to prove what we cannot understand, what we cannot know. So again, I hope that that was interesting in a measure. It's also, I believe, informative and somewhat representative of Rambam's bigger theories about knowledge and about HaKadosh Baruch Hu. There is another thing interesting here, and that is, we saw that the Mishnah has three parts. The first part was Akol Tzafui V'Reshut Netanah, which we just expanded on. The second part I'm not going to speak about, B'Tov HaOlam Nidon, the world is judged favorably, which is a very interesting concept, but I'm now skipping it. The third concept in the Mishnah by Rabbi Akiva, Hakol Lefi Rov Amaseh. Everything goes according to the majority of the deeds. Now, what does that mean? So one may think that it means that the way human beings are being judged are according to the majority of their deeds, right? That's our, we have this depiction of God sitting with this Moznaim scales, and you put all of the mitzvot on one scale and all of the avirot on the other, and it's pop, 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 pop. And then hopefully the scale with the mitzvot would tip down and everything would be fine, right? That's more, that's how the ganenet in the kindergarten explained to us how it goes, and so it must be true. But Rambam does not believe that that's the way it goes. Not only because the scales are only a mashal, right? Only this, I hope that we all understand, right? There are no huge scales up in the sky, okay? But also because it is not correct to assume that people are being judged according to numbers. So I have 752 mitzvot this year, and six, and that's not the way it goes. Rambam says it explicitly in his Ilchot Shuvah, in the, I think it's, if I remember correctly, it's the third chapter of Ilchot Shuvah in his Mishneh Torah. He says, we should know that it doesn't go according to the count, but according to the quality. So it's not quantity, it's quality. And sometimes one mitzvah can be more important than 1,200 others, and it also personalized. So it may be that what is extremely a great mitzvah for me, it's a great deed. Why? Because of my history, because of my temptation. I don't know why. Would be something very minor for you, and vice versa. Also on Aveirot, it might be that someone would be judged very harshly for a certain Aveira, let's say Moshe Rabbeinu, or something on this, excuse me, on this scale, be judged very harshly for an Avera, that if someone like me would do this Avera, so that it would be a mitzvah for me, right? So everything is according to the specific person we speak about. So if that is so, what does it mean when Rabbi Akiva says, Hakol Lefi Rov HaMaaseh? He does speak here about numbers and about deeds, so how would Rambam explain that? So Rambam, let's read it inside. Achar Kach Amar, you see? אחר כך אמר שהמעלות לא יוסגו לפי שיעור גודל המעשה אלא לפי רוב מספר המעשה. Rambam takes it into the moral realm. And when I speak about morals in Rambam, and that's again very, I think, very important, very interesting. We in the modern world tend to see morals as referring to the quality of a specific deed. So if you, for example, would listen or maybe attend to a morals course in university, so they would speak about such questions as, if I have a train, right, and it's going to hit one person, and I'm able to move it, it would hit 5%, and I'm able to move it so it would hit one. So is it moral for me to cause the death of one in order to save five? Or is it more moral to me to refrain from doing? So that's an example to a subject of morality. Obviously, there are many, many others. How do you share resources among the different people in your country? And many other questions of justice, of morals. That is extremely far from how Rambam understands morals. And Rambam here is, in a sense, also affected not only by Halacha and Yahadut, but also by Lehavdil Aristotle. So that's important to know. For Rambam, morals are not about what is the right or the wrong deed. Morals are about how to develop the right character. So it's more about, I would say something sharp, which obviously needs a whole series by itself. But for Rambam, morals are more about psychology than about what we call today moral principles. Because the question is a certain act, good or not good? What does it mean good? So for Rambam, good is functional. What is a good oven? Right? What is a good tap? Right? So a good oven is an oven that heats. So what is a good act? A good act is an act that performs, that achieves what it should achieve. Now, again, and the main question is not what would it achieve in the world, but what would it achieve in me as the doer? So when I give tzedakah, it's important to give tzedakah, no question. It's all important also for the ani who is being given the tzedakah, no question. But the most important aspect of tzedakah is what does it create within me? What is the experience? What is, as he says, the midot, I think that would be virtues in English. So what virtue do I develop by giving tzedakah? And here Rambam says it's a psychological rule, but for him, psychology is the foundation of morals, as I just explained in, I guess, too short way. But Rambam says, the way that human psychology works is you are more affected by small deeds happening a lot of times than by a large deed happening only once. Just a basic, just an educational rule. So if I will, just once in my life, I would wake up very early for Shachrit. So it would be very nice, and they would have a whole learning session. Really nice, but the long impact of it would be almost nothing. If I would wake up for Shachrit, not very well, not very early, just regular Shachrit, but every day, that would have a much more fundamental impact on my personality, on my virtues. It is more important, and that's what Rambam is understanding from what Rabbi Akiva says here. And that is the same Rabbi Akiva, obviously, you remember standing on the well and seeing the water drops. So you would just aim a large wave of water against a stone, nothing would happen. But very small drops, every minute, for hours, for days, for years, in the end, they would make a hole in the stone. Right? That's the big Torah of Rabbi Akiva. That's how he was able, in the age of 40, to begin to learn Torah. But he said, okay, even if we take very small steps, but I would do it godly, I would do it slowly, safely, but I would not give up. So you can acquire everything with this type of an approach. And says Rambam, that is what Rabbi Akiva is also saying here. Virtues are being acquired, not according to the, we would say the bigness?
Size,
yeah. Thank you. The size of the act, but by perseverance. If you are doing it again and again. So he says, it is better to give. Let's say I have $1,000 I can give in tzedakah. Here, that is my maaser. It is better to give 1,000 times a dollar than to give $1,000 in one act. Now, you may claim, and you may be right in that, you would argue, that for the poor person, it's better one person with $1,000 than 1,000 poor men with another dollar. That would, because that would change nothing in their life. And you may be right. But for the person giving, if I want to develop the trait of netina, of giving, then giving 1,000 times would impact me much more than the giving of $1,000 in one instance. So that's a very sharp moral observance, right, by the Rambam. And it can be argued with. Because people that are more consequential, they would say, no, we want the act to be as consequential in the world, not in yourself. That's a big question, where more should be aimed. So that's a very important debate that obviously we would not go into. Some would say maybe that that again, practically, if you'd give $1,000 in one time, you'd give more in the end. So maybe that can also be a discussion. So we can open a whole discussion. But what Rambam is teaching us here is that, you know, we speak about that with our students in the yeshiva. I prefer someone that would come into the Beit Midrash at 8:30 in the morning for Seder Boker and go to his lunch break at 1 and only return at 3 p.m. I mean, what you do is sedarim, is learning according to the clock. But you do it, again, in a perseverance way, every day, every day, every day. Then someone that would sit up to 12 or 1 a.m. to the small hours of the night, and you'd give his, you know, be dedicated. But in the end, he would wake up in the next morning. And the next day, again, he would completely switch night and day. So maybe we'd learn more hours in a given week, but you would not develop the learning habits that in the end can make someone into a great learner. Because there is a big difference between someone that is running for short distance, right? And he gives a sprint for 100 meters and that's the end of it, and someone who runs a marathon for 40, I don't know what is, 30 miles or whatever the length of marathon. I mean, I cannot run even 100 meters, so that's not taking it as an example. But just they say that that's the way it goes, right? So that's, we want to develop marathon runners and not sprinters. So Rambam says we should invest in many small deeds. That's more important than giving one great act of kindness. So that's, I think, another very interesting observation by the Rambam. So that is from Perush HaMishnah. Now we go on to the second part of our shiur, in which we'll discuss the Mishnah Torah. Here I wrote a whole chapter from the Mishnah Torah. I understand that there is no way we'd be able to learn all of it, but let's just have a taste. It is the last chapter of the Mishnah Torah. So it is, again, it is not very representative, I would admit immediately. Why? Because it almost does say nothing about halacha. And the majority of the Mishnah Torah, obviously, is focused on halacha. It's a code of law. But for Rambam, code of law does not include only what you should do. It also includes what you should believe. That is very different. I think we spoke about it from the Shulchan Aruch, for example. So Rambam begins with, you should know that there is a God. That's how Rambam begins his Mishnah Torah. Shulchan Aruch begins with, you should wake up in the morning and go to tefillah. You see the difference. So Rambam also ends his Shulchan Aruch with a discussion about Yemot HaMashiach. Because we speak about what we have to believe. That's the end of days. So it is appropriate, it would appear in the end of his work, the end of the code of the laws. So let's learn again, just a taste. So this is the 12th chapter of, it calls the laws of kings. Kings is something that for Rambam, a Jewish king is already taking us immediately into the realm of Mashiach. All right, so the Ilchot of Mashiach are in the end of the laws of kings. Al yaleh al halev. Says, by the way, now watch the language also. Because when we learned the Perush HaMishnah, it was a translation. Perush HaMishnah was written in Arabic and was translated. Here, it's Rambam's words. So it's worth taking them into your heart. Al yaleh al halev, says Rambam, do not think shebimot HaMashiach ibatel davar miminago shel olam o yesham chidush b'maase bereshit. El ha'olam keminago noeg. So Rambam immediately begins with a bombshell, right? He says, do not even consider that in the days of Mashiach, the world would change in its physical reality. There would be no difference. The world would continue as it had been. There would be nothing new in Maase Bereshit. Maase Bereshit is physics. So do not imagine things floating in the air or a new sun coming in. The physical world for Rambam, I just say a few sentences about it. The world was created by HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So he set the laws. That means that they are the best laws that you can have, because the Kadosh Baruch Hu would not do anything that would be less than the best possible world. So if you would say that in the days of the Mashiach, the world would be better, that is implying that our world is not the best, that HaKadosh would somehow improve. That is heresy, right? Saying that HaKadosh would improve. HaKadosh is perfect. He began as, I mean, he didn't begin. So again, we have difficulties every time we try to speak about HaKadosh Baruch Hu in the Rambam's philosophical sense. But God is perfect. That's something that we can say. Obviously not perfect in our sense of perfectness, but he's perfect. So it did already the best that can be done. So our world is the best that can be. Do not expect any fundamental changes in the physics. So what changes can you expect? What is not perfect in this world? Everything that God created is perfect. So what is not perfect? What is the only thing that human... I already gave the answer. Right? What is the only thing that God gave the control over to something other than himself? Well, the answer obviously is our own behavior. Because Harishut Netuna, right? God gave us the ability to choose. So the only thing that is imperfect in this world is human beings. So what can be perfected in the times of the Mashiach? Humans. El ha'olam keminago noeg, v'ze she'ne'emar b'Yishaya, v'gar ze'ev im keves v'namer im gedir batz. So Rambam says, you attack me. I'm saying that nothing would change. But Yeshaya says that a wolf would live with sheep, and namer, a tiger, would live with gdi. Gdi is a lamb, right? So how can it be? So that seems to explicitly say there would be a change, at least in the way that animals behave. So that requires a change in biology. It says that's mashal v'chida. That's only a mashal, it's a proba. It is not, you shouldn't read it literally. What does it mean? עניין הדבר שיהיו ישראל יושבים לבטח עם רשעי העקום, רשעי הגויים, המשולים כזאב ונמר. So what it really means, who are the real wolves of this world? The reshaim, right? The people that behave, the people that are predators. So these are the people that would change. Thank you. These are the people that would change their behavior, not the animals. The animal kingdom is perfect as it is, again, because they do not have choice. If God would have thought that it is better for animals not to eat each other, it would already have been done. So if God had made the world in a way that animals prey on each other, then that's the best way. And we know that. We know from biology. We know that there are chains of food. It's very important. If they would really stop to eat each other, the world would not be a nice place to live in. So it is very important that they limit and balance and check out each other. We don't want that to stop. If wolves would stop to eat lambs, then we would even have an ecological crisis in our hands. So that is not what we are aspiring to. So what does it mean when Yeshaya says that wolves would not eat lambs anymore? Well, there are human beings that are like lambs because they are very incest. There are human beings that are like wolves because they are predators, and that would stop. So what would become perfect is the only thing that is imperfect, that is human behavior. Now, even if we stop here, so that is the vision to Yemot HaMashiach. Not thinking about, the world, balls of fire coming in. No, that's a very different, everything that would speak in such a way, Rambam would see it, would translate that in a figurative, as a figurative speech, as illiteral. V'yachzeru kulam, skip a little, v'yachzeru kulam ledat ha'emet. So everyone would return to the true religion, which obviously is Yahadut. It doesn't mean that everyone would convert, but it means that people would believe in the tenets that Yahadut teaches. Lo yigzelu velo yashchitu, so people would stop stealing, vandalizing. Ela yochlu davar amutar benachat im Israel. So you just eat what you are allowed to eat. And again, allowed to eat here is in the moral sense. What would make you a better person? Now, it may be that eating too much meat Rambam would say, would not be good for you, not on the physical aspect and not on the spiritual aspect. So not necessarily that we are speaking, let's say, against being a vegetarian, but it doesn't mean that the whole world would become vegetarian, because that, again, that would seem to imply that God somehow missed when he created the world with people as carnivores. So that is a mistake. That's a mistake. Everything that God did is perfect.
וכן כיוצא באלו, כל הדברים בעניין המשיח הם משלים, ובימות המלך המשיח יוודע לאיזה דבר היה משל.
So Rambam says, and by the way, it's not that I know every figurative idiom or image to explain exactly what I don't know, but one thing I do know, do not expect any physical difference. The difference would be in the human behavior. And in the days of the Mashiach, we would see what exactly would be, what exactly that would mean. Now, the Rabbeinu Avraham ben David, about whom we learned in the past, so he comments on that, a very short, but this short comment obviously hides behind itself a very long, different tradition. And he says, Al yaleh al alev shebimot ha-Mashiach kulei ad meshalim, so he comments on that, ve'alo batorah ve'hishbati chaya ra'a minas. No, it says, Rabbi says, no, it's not only in the Nevim, it's also written in the Torah that there would be no more bad animals in the land. Now, what would Rabbi answer to that? And that's also a mashal. Rabbi would not be scared, but Rabbi is coming for such a different tradition in which things are being taken much, much, much more literally. Now, he would also know, you understand, it's a question of measure, of quantities. I mean, Rabbi would also admit that when the Torah says that the hand of God would strike Paro, so no one imagined a huge hand coming down from heaven and giving Paro a patch. Right, so we all understand that sometimes, as figurative speaking, that's clear. But to what extent do we take that? That's a big question. So when, for example, we know there is a Midrash saying that the temple, the third temple would go down in fire from heavens. So the Ashkenazic tradition, which is much more literal, as I said, would say, yeah, that is just the way that it's going to happen. That there would be a huge something. I do not know exactly how it would happen, but you know, it's a miracle. So there would be a huge building coming down from heaven in fire, engulfed in fire, maybe to be built up of fire. I would expect everything that God would give. I'm fine with either way. Rambam says, no, that's a mistake. If you want to take this Agada into account, then we would say something along the lines that the building would be as fast like, it would be as fast as fire, or it would be as shining as fire. Maybe we would find, and again, or maybe we would say, you know, I do not understand exactly what the mashal is, but I know one thing for sure. No building made out of fire is going to come down from heaven, because physically that is impossible. And that's why Rambam has long detailed halachot about how we are supposed to build the Beit HaMikdash, because we are not supposed to wait for the Beit HaMikdash to come down from heaven engulfed in flames. We are supposed just to build it. So again, very different views. Now, as I said earlier, I am happy with any way that it would happen. I mean, I am not necessarily going with the Rambam or with his opponents, but we can all understand the differences here. When we say that God would take us back on the wings of eagles, back from the diaspora to Eretz Israel, does that mean that we are supposed to wait in the diaspora till eagles would land and we would go on the eagles and come to Eretz Israel? Or does it mean that we should aspire and we should try and we should go physically to Eretz Israel and God would help us and it would be as speedy as being on the wing of eagles? That's a big question. That's a big question. I have to say that if more people would hear Rambam in Europe of the 20s or the 30s, then we would be in a better situation, right? And not wait for eagles to land down. Who knows? Maybe planes are the eagles. Who knows what the figurative speech It's like, personally, I have to say that's what I believe. You don't have to take it. It's just my understanding. But I do believe that if a Navi 3,000 years ago would have been seen an image of a plane taking people, how can he explain it? What is language? What can he say in his language? I mean, I think that speaking about people taken on the wings of eagles would be a very accurate description of what he saw. So if you see an image of the future with planes taking people, that's how would you speak if you lived 3,000 years ago. So I believe that's a combination of saying that human behavior should change because people should aspire more to go to Eretz Israel, but also that the physical world changed. Now, it changed in the way that even Rambam couldn't imagine a plane, but it doesn't really mean that physics have changed, right? It's very interesting the way that these things play out. So again, if I would imagine for a second, let's say Beit HaMikdash is being built, we are not allowed to use iron in being the Beit HaMikdash. Let's say that we would cut the stones with lasers. Doesn't that in a sense seems to you as close to the description of Beit HaMikdash coming in flames? I don't know, I'm throwing out, that's thoughts I have. Obviously, I don't know what is the expression in the book, and don't look at me as that. That's just, I don't know, that's just theory, that's just speculations. I share them with you. Okay, it's so interesting, but I have to, you have the page. If you want, it's a very easy Hebrew, as you can see. Also, you can find the English translations on Sepharia, also on the Chabad website, by the way. They have a very nice English translation. Of the Rambam, and you can use and you can see what he says. I'm skipping now. It's give me a heartache to skip all of that. It's so beautiful, but let's skip to. You know what? I cannot skip the last halacha. Just very short. What is the purpose of Yemot HaMashiach? Why do we hope for them? So we can live as kings, so we can conquer the whole world, so people would admire us, so we can say, you know, we told you. That's the real Jewish, right? Why do we want Yemot HaMashiach? We were right and you were wrong along the whole way. But no, says Rambam, no, that's not the point. That's the last halacha, halacha hey. You see it in the second side of the page, and that is the last halacha in all of the Mishneh Torah. Be'oto azman, so in the days of the Mashiach, lo yesham lo ra'ah velo milchama velo kin'ah v'tacharut. So the world would become perfect again. In what sense? In human behavior. So there would be no famine. You know that someone got a Nobel Prize for a guy from India. He proved that in the last few hundred years, every time there was a shortage of food, it was never because of shortage of food. It was because of shortage of justice. That's the way that he put it. He got the Nobel Prize for that. Because the question is, how do you divide? That's amazing. God always gives enough resources. The question is, how do you divide them? If there is a shortage of justice, then people will die out of hunger. But that's not because of God, that's because of human beings. So there would be, so says Rama, there would be no famine, no ra'av, no war, no jealousy, no competition. So it seems to envision some way of a communist future, I guess. No competition. So everything, you can go to the supermarket and you can buy food very cheap. I think that Trump, okay. V'chol ha-ma'adanim metzuim ke'afar. So you can go, you can buy, I don't know, bananas. You can buy things from, again, things that was, I cannot hold myself, but you would have to listen. So the Gemara, when the Gemara wants to describe someone that is very rich, the Gemara says he has a batzal, onion, throughout the whole year. On his table, because he's able to import onion. Can you imagine what they would have said if they would just go into a supermarket here in Tel Mont and you can buy everything and it's cheap? You can buy. You can obviously, if you want, I don't know what, you can always want things that are beyond your abilities. But I do not speak about abilities, I speak about needs. And that's Amadanim metzuim ke'afar. So everything, all the good food is like scent. Right? It's like, I mean, ask my children, they behave to food like sand. Why? Because it's so cheap and there is always, they never, Baruch Hashem, it should never be otherwise, but they never felt a shortage of anything, right? So they, sometimes we don't know how to value things when we always had what to eat. So we don't know how to value what we have. And then when we will have everything that we need, lo ye esek haolam ela ladat et Hashem bilvad. So we all just sit in shiurim like that. We'd all just sit and learn. Because why not? Why not? Why to work for what? If you can buy bread and hummus and some meat for Shabbat, what else do you need? So you can have a lot of free time in your hand. Obviously, that depends on who you are, right? Because if we want the largest house and the newest car and the newest iPhone, I don't know what, then yes, then we can, or Android, I do not say anything about iPhone or whatever else. But you know, if we are chasing always the best of physicality, then yes, we would need to spend our life in working in order to achieve the things. But in the end, says Rambam, the question is, what do you want to be? Who do you want to be when you would be grown up? And if you have what you need, then just sit and learn. Just sit and learn. That's an amazing, obviously he was an intellectual. And I guess that he saw other people also as intellectuals, or at least in intellectual as in potential. There would be people that would say, no, it's not who am I. I cannot sit and learn for 12. It's not a question of having to work to earn salary. It's having to work because that's what gives me certification. That's I would become mad if I would sit for 12 or 14 hours a day. And so it may be that we have to support, expand this vision in order to include everyone. But nonetheless, even just what Rambam says here, I think is so beautiful. So that's what we aspire to. We aspire to a world in which everyone has the possibility, if you just want to sit and learn. And learn metaphysics, learn what is really important, learn about God. And so human beings, let's begin with Israel. So Am Israel would be chachamim gdolim, would be able to learn. By the way, that's the word again, that we live here now. I mean, we can complain about the education system and we should educate, we should complain, we should try to improve it. But anyone who knows anything about history knows that there was never such an ability as we have today. To teach children to the age of 18. And then the rate of people going to a higher education is astounding. There was never an ability just because people have to work in order to be able to feed themselves. So you can learn to the age of 10, let's say, and only very, very few. Very few were able to continue learning. But nowadays that we have food as sand, then we are able to invest in teaching and in learning. So you Israel chachamim gdolim, v'yodim dvarim astumim, and they know things that are difficult. V'yasigu dat bo'am kfi koach ha'adam, they would be able to achieve according to human ability. So it is qualification, but according to human ability, they would be able to understand the Kadosh Baruch Hu. As it says, she'ne'emar, ki mal'a ha'aretz de'a et Hashem, kamayim layam mechasim. Because then we would fulfill this nevuah that the world would be full knowledge of God as the water fill the sea. As the water, so it goes into every crack, right? It's not something that's only superficial. In the same way, the knowledge of God in the days of the Mashiach would penetrate everywhere. So I do believe that you are in the process, but I think that's very, very, very inspiring. A very inspiring picture. We were not able to learn from the Moira Nevuchim, but you know what? We should all always aspire to learn more. So it's good to end with this note, and Be'ezot Hashem, we would continue to our next gadol, to our next hero next week, and have a great week. Be'ezot Hashem. I didn't made up my mind yet. To be honest, I think that we'll do another one before Ramban. So, because there is some gap here, maybe Rabbeinu Yonah. The possibilities now are so amazing. Also, I have to admit that I have a spot, I have a weak spot for Rabbi Avraham ben Rambam, so the son of the Rambam, because he was such a great man, and his only flaw was that he was the son of the Rambam. And when you are in the shade of such a tree, you just have no chance to stand for yourself. Even his name is Rabbi Avraham ben Rambam. Oh, it doesn't, it's not fair. So I don't know. Maybe we'll do him. Or maybe we'll do first Rabbeinu and then him. We'll see. We'll see. What I can say is that the Sfardim are going to rule now for a time, because they are very strong in the period we speak about. So just embrace yourself for that. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye bye.